In this example, I'd like to look at something known as a strain rosette. And this is something that's used in experimental work for determining states of strain. And the way it works is one pastes small metallic gauges onto the surface of an object that's being strained, and one measures the normal strain in various directions in space. And so a strain gauge only measures normal strain in a given orientation. And usually what you do is you paste up gauges in a couple of different directions, and using those normal strains, one tries to determine what the state of strain in the object is. So let's consider a strain gauge rosette that has a gauge oriented in what we call the zero direction, so that's the x direction, a gauge oriented in the 90 degree direction, and a gauge oriented at 22.5 degrees. So you can think of these as being pasted onto the surface of an object that's then going to be loaded. And let's assume that we load the object and we measure a normal strain in the zero direction of 100 microstrain. We measure a normal strain of 200 microstrain in the 90 degree direction. And we measure a normal strain of 100 microstrain at 22.5 degrees. And what we'd like to determine is what are the normal and shear strains relative to the x and y axes of the system here. So we're given three normal strains, and we'd like to determine two normal strains and a shear strain for the system. So first of all, the normal strains in the x and the y direction are trivial because we have strain gauges in the x and the y direction. So epsilon xx is epsilon 0, so that's 100 microstrain, and epsilon yy is epsilon 90, so that's equal to 200 microstrain. So I immediately know what the normal strains are in the x and the y directions because I pasted gauges in those two directions. So the only thing that's to be determined is what is the shear strain in the xy direction. Now, what we do know is what the normal strain is at 22.5 degrees. And what I can do is write that in terms of the strains in the x and the y directions using the double angle version of the transformation laws. So here I have the mean normal strain. Here I have the difference in normal strains divided by 2, and I have the shear strain. And if you think about this, I actually know most of the terms here. I know the left-hand side. I know the normal strain values. I know the angle. The only thing that I don't know is this shear strain here. So I can use the relationship to solve for that shear strain. So plugging in pi over 8, or 22.5 degrees for the angle, I can write out this expression. So the normal strain at 22.5 degrees is 100. The mean normal strain is 150. The difference divided by 2 is minus 50. And so I have my only unknown here, which is epsilon xy. So I can solve for epsilon xy. I get 50 times 1 minus root 2 microstrain. And to get the engineering shear strain, that's twice the tensorial shear strain, I end up with 100 times 1 minus root 2. So that's going to be a negative number. So if I were to think about drawing the deformation, if I started with a little square here, that means that it's going to elongate in the x direction, and it's going to elongate a bit more in the y direction, but the angle between the x and the y axis is going to open up. So I'm going to have an opening of the angle, and I'll have some strain in that direction, and I'll have some strain in the x direction. The strain in the y direction is going to be larger. So you can think of that as the state of deformation. So there's some normal strain in this direction, that's 100 microstrain. There's strain in this direction, which is double the value in the x direction. And then there's the 90 degree angle here opens up by this value here, and it's opening up because it's negative here. If it were a positive shear strain, it would be closing, and the object would sort of shear in the other direction.